Good morning. Hello. Good morning. We welcome you today. Oh, my goodness. I'm seeing lots of laughter and conversation, and that makes me so happy. So I'm glad that our church family has gathered today. We just want to share a few announcements with you in the life of our church before we begin our worship today. Today is our annual general meeting. We hope that you can stay. It'll begin promptly at 11:30. Childcare is available, which is wonderful, so let that not be a deterrent. There's also lunch available. Our regular soup is available, but also they've made some yummy sandwiches, a variety of kinds. And sandwiches are sold for $2, but if you don't have a toonie, grab a sandwich. We want you to not come to our meeting hungry. We want you to stay if you can and help us pray our church forward. There's a card in the chapel hall for Jack Wallace. If anyone would like to sign that, his pastoral care leader will be bringing that to him this week. So check in at the end of service. We're having a pancake dinner on February 28th from 4 till 7 p.m. The cost is $7. If you're under 5, raise your hand if you're under 5. You eat... Okay, I see some cheaters. Okay, that's fine. Okay. If you're under 5, you get to eat for free. So we want to see the church family out that night for a yummy pancake supper. That's February 28th. We're also looking for a little bit of help with serving. So if you're able to help, please speak with Kathy. We're also having an Ash Wednesday service the following night, and that will be March 1st at 6:30. Pastor Reed Cook will be presiding over that service. So come on out and begin our Lenten journey together. And some of you may have been to our meet and eat supper that happens every Wednesday night. Would be a great night to come out and have supper and then stay for the Ash Wednesday service. Also, just so you know, during Lent, we're inviting and encouraging people to bring a canned good when they come to meet and eat. So just keep that in mind when you come. We'll be thinking of those less fortunate during the journey of Lent. World Day of Prayer is coming up, and that's when the whole city kind of comes together, and actually, more than the city, the people all over the world gather to pray and do a service. And so in our city, our church has been chosen as the church to host that. It's March 3rd at 1 p.m. with lunch to follow, so if you're available, we'll invite you to come to that. Also, we are having a Lenten speaker series, which begins next week, and we have some awesome speakers lined up for all of Lent. We'll invite Reverend Adam Kilner next Sunday, and I'll have a little bit of biographical information in the e-news as well as in the bulletin next week. He's a phenomenal speaker out of Sarnia, United Church Minister. Following week, Reverend Martha Lockwood, who is from Ridgeway. So we have an opportunity to hear some new voices and celebrate the diversity in the United Church. So we look forward to that. Let us unite our hearts and pray as we prepare our hearts for worship. Great God, we love you, we adore you, and we come here to praise you this morning. We come here with hearts that are full, some of them full of joy and excitement that it's snowing this morning and that a new week is about to begin. Some of us may have a more difficult time today entering into worship. And so, Lord, we are so grateful that we can just come as we are today and bring all that we are and all that we aren't before you. And that you bless us, Lord, and that we can be reminded today of your promises over us and who you are to us, God, a beloved Father. And so, Lord, we open our hearts to you now and ask you, Holy Spirit, to fill us. May we hear from you this morning in the worship, in the word. May we open our ears and hearts to speak, that you'll speak to us, God. And we just pray that you would bless our time together this morning. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Good morning. On behalf of the worship team, welcome here. Would you please stand and join with us as we sing our first song? And you'll see the theme of this song, and that last line in the first slide. Waiting here is one. We are here to wait before our God who invites us not as individuals, putting everything else aside, but coming together as one body, his body.
There is power, power here in this hour, we're all together, together, waiting here as one. There is power, power here in this hour. We're all together, together, waiting here as one. Whoa, 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 hear the sound from heaven. Whoa, 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 a mighty rushing wind. Whoa, 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 we're calling for revival. God, let your fire fall again. It's burning in my soul. It's burning in my soul. All your sons and your daughters dreaming the dreams of their father, seeing the signs and the wonders, the kingdom of God. Yeah, yeah. Whoa, whoa, whoa. Hear the sound from heaven. Whoa, whoa, whoa. A mighty rushing wind. Whoa, whoa, whoa. We're calling for revival. God, let your fire fall again. It's burning in my soul. I cannot contain it, so let it shine. I cannot contain it, this light of mine. It's burning in my soul. Hear the sound from heaven. Whoa, whoa, whoa. A mighty rushing wind. Whoa, whoa, whoa. We're calling for revival. God, let your fire fall again. It's burning in my soul. It's burning in my soul. Yeah, it's burning in my soul. It's burning in my soul. In my soul. In my soul. In my soul. There's power, power here in this hour, this hour. We're all together, together, waiting here as one. Waiting here as one. Waiting here as one.
God, indeed, we do put ourselves aside and come together as your people, your one people. We thank you for this chance to be here to worship this morning, and we pray you would light our hearts afire. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Take a moment to introduce yourself to somebody near you. Say hello, introduce by name, and the kids are going to come on up in a couple of minutes.
Come on up, boys and girls. We have a very special story and a very special storyteller for you this morning. Good to see you. Are you all excited today? Yay! Good to see you guys. Well, and if there are any other boys and girls in the congregation, we invite them up. And for you boys and girls that I have not had the pleasure of meeting before, my name is Reed, Pastor Reed, and I have a very beautiful lady beside me this morning. No, I'm thinking of you. I like your glasses. Anyway, I have two beautiful ladies beside me this morning and lots of beautiful kids, but I have a special lady here, and her name is Esther. Can you say hi to Esther?
Hi, Esther.
Yeah, and she's got a very special story to tell you this morning, and so you listen, and I'm sure that you're going to learn about someone new, perhaps that you never heard about before. So, Esther, if you would please.
Yeah, so good morning, everybody. Good to see your beautiful smiling faces. So I want to tell you a story this morning that I think is one of the best stories ever. It's about a guy with a really strange name. His name was Bartimaeus. Can you say that?
Bartimaeus.
Not bad, not bad. Mm. But because it's kind of a long, complicated name, we'll just call him Bart. Is that okay? So when this little fellow was born, he was actually, they could tell right from the beginning, that he was a little bit different from most babies. They could tell that. And as he got a little bit older, it became pretty clear that he was pretty different from most babies. And then when he got to be a child, people started to like, oh, get away from us. You're not the same as us. They kind of bullied him a little bit. It's not really very nice, is it? It was quite different. Just hang on to that thought. And so when he got a little bit older, it became quite clear that what was wrong with him, do you know? Anybody know? He was actually, you know, I bet you can't guess. He was blind. He couldn't see. Everybody put their hand over their eyes right now. Really, 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 really tightly. And if you're doing it right, you can't even see anything. Is everybody doing it? No peeking? You can't see. Can you imagine what that would be like to go through life? I need a boy. Can I have a volunteer? Could you be my volunteer? Okay, come on up here. I need a boy. Not that I don't like the girls, but I need a boy because he's kind of like what blind Bartimaeus was. It was obviously a boy. So what I want to do is, maybe you could help me out here, Pastor Reed. We could put this little cover on your eyes. Do you mind? Just so that you can kind of see what it's like to be blind Bart. And that was the nickname they gave him, blind Bart. How does that feel? What's your name? How does that feel, Benjamin? Is it a bit scary?
No.
Can you see anything?
Not really.
Not really. And that's the way blind Bart spent his life. And so what happened with him is as he got older, people kind of like, oh, you go away, go away, go away. Don't come near us. You're different. And so he ended up being out on the street. And because he didn't really have any money, he had a tin cup. And maybe it looked a little bit like this old tin cup that I found in our basement. And he would sit on the side, because he had no money to buy food, and he would sit on the side of the road, and he would hold up the cup, and he would hope and hope and hope that somebody might come by. He would hear people coming by, but he couldn't see them. And every now and then he'd hear a noise, and that noise would be probably somebody putting something in the cup. Hopefully somebody soon will put a little bit of something in the cup. Did you hear that, blind Bart? Did you hear that noise? And what did that mean? That somebody was giving him something so that he could buy food, and we call it money. And then, oh, sorry, he would be very, very, very happy. Well, he kind of thought, this is the way my life is going to be. I'm not going to be able to ever see. But then, one time he was sitting in his usual place, and he started to hear a noise. And the noise was coming from somewhere way down the road, and he couldn't, like most people, look and try to figure out what it was. He couldn't see anything. So he just heard this noise, and it was getting louder and louder, and people were shouting, and they were cheering, and they were yelling, but they weren't angry. They were very, very happy. And he thought, I wonder what's happening. It must be maybe some big special king or something is coming our way. And then he heard someone say, it's him! It's him! He's coming! It's Jesus! And he thought, I've heard about this guy. I've heard about this Jesus. I've heard that he can touch people and make them well. Maybe this is my chance. Maybe this is my chance. And so he thought, I don't care what people think of me. I'm going to ask for help. And so he stood up, and in the loudest voice possible, he yelled, Jesus, have mercy on me. Jesus, help me. And then people started to get mad at him. And they started saying, oh, be quiet. Nobody cares about what you want, blind Bart. Nobody cares. Jesus, he's busy. He's got places to go and people to see. He doesn't have time for you. But blind Bart said, I'm just going to keep at this. So he yelled, Jesus, Jesus, have mercy on me. Jesus, help me. And all of a sudden, something happened. It's very exciting. All of a sudden, everything went very, very quiet. Not a sound. And then he heard a voice. And the voice said, bring him to me. And he thought to himself, I wonder if that's Jesus. I wonder if he's calling for me. Sure enough, people said to him, blind Bart, come with us. And they took him by the arm. And they said, he wants to see you. So he got up. Let's get Spencer to get up. Can you get up? And can you go and stand? Pastor Reed will lead you because, you know, you're blind. You can't see anything. Well, there you are. So they stood him in front of Jesus. And he didn't know. And, you know, you have to remember, this is a little boy that was born blind. And he'd never seen a face in his whole entire life. You know how when we're born and we're babies, and you've seen babies do this, the first thing they look at is their mommy's face. And they love their mommy's face so much. And they want to always look at their mommy's face. But blind Bart, the closest he ever came to knowing anybody's face would be to touch someone's face and maybe feel them. But you can't really tell what a person looks like by feeling their face, can you? So there he is standing in front of Jesus. And then a really interesting thing happened. Because Jesus, I mean, it's pretty obvious what this little boy wanted, what this man wanted, this young man. But Jesus said to him, what would you like me to do? Doesn't that seem like a strange thing? It's pretty obvious he wanted to be able to see. But he said to him, Jesus said to him, what would you like me to do? It's kind of like sometimes we have to tell Jesus exactly what we'd like him to do. We have to tell him. We don't want to say, oh, help me, God. We have to say, Lord, I need help with this. And so Jesus said, what would you have me to do? And that was the really exciting part. And the Bible says that Jesus actually touched him. And I believe he probably even took his face in his hands. And when blind Bartimaeus said, Lord, that I could have my sight, suddenly he could see. And the first face he looked at, and can you hold his face, please? And turn him up. The first face he looked at was the face of Jesus. And let me tell you, that was the best face that anybody could see. And Spencer, can you just look up at Pastor Reed's face for a minute and pretend? And what do you see on Pastor Reed's face besides his glasses and his beard? What do you see? A big smile. And I believe that Jesus probably had a grin from ear to ear. You can come back and sit down. Thanks for being our helper. The best face that you could see. And that was such a life-changing thing for blind Bart that he became a Jesus follower right then and there. And then when Jesus said, well, gonna have to get going now, blind Bart, no longer blind, said, can I come too? And he followed him down the road, and he followed him the rest of his life. He had a life-changing meeting with Jesus. Isn't that so amazing? Isn't that so amazing? Because Jesus changes our lives with his love. So I'm going to ask Pastor Reed to pray over the children now before you go to your class. Good.
Well, that's great. So remember Bartimaeus, and was it Spencer or your name?
Benjamin.
I thought it was Benjamin, yeah.
Oh, well, I'm sorry, I thought it was Spencer.
No, and here you go. There's your money. That's from the Actors Guild. You did a great job.
And here's your other money.
There you go. Okay, boys and girls, remember when I was with you last time, I taught you how to pray. Put your hand over your finger or your thumb, and that's Jesus holding on to you. So let's just have a little word of prayer. Heavenly Father, thank you for these boys and girls. God, how you love the children. And love on these children, love on their moms and dads and in their homes. And may they know the wonderful joy of looking into Jesus' eyes and knowing his love. So bless them. Give them a wonderful day now in their own time of worship. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you, boys and girls. Have a great day. Ooh, you got to do your bow.
Thanks for sitting beside me.
Well, as these children make their way out of the sanctuary to have their time together, we, the big children, have a chance to let God take our hand, our face in his hands, and we get to gaze right into his eyes and understand that as we pray to him, he is a good, good father.
Oh, I've heard a thousand stories of what they think you're like, but I've heard the tender whisper of love in the dead of night, and you tell me that you're pleased and that I'm never alone. You're a good, good father. It's who you are, it's who you are, it's who you are. I'm loved by you, it's who I am, it's who I am, it's who I am. I've seen many searching for answers far. I know we're all searching for answers. Only you provide, 'cause you know just what we need before we say a word. You're a good, good father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are.
Come to you in these quiet moments, seeking your presence. How often our noisy hearts drown out so much that you would have us hear, including your voice, God. We come to you this morning with regrets of yesterday and anxieties about tomorrow. Lord of our lives, although we cannot know what lies ahead, we can have confidence that you will be there today and in our tomorrows, faithfully walking beside us. We thank you today, gracious Lord, for those among us who enjoy a sense of peace and accomplishment, finding your blessings in their work and play. Equally, we are mindful of those who are dispirited in life and feeling unsure of their purpose and direction. Wherever we find ourselves, we pray that you would refresh our spirits and strengthen our sense of assurance in our worth as your beloved children. You, our faithful Father. We thank you, Lord of our life, for those who are blessed with good health this day. And we pray for your special care for those whose health is uncertain and those who live with bodily or emotional pain or disability. Reassure us that we can lean in with confidence, that your strong arms can hold us no matter what we face. We are grateful that your divine care also comes to us through those who extend a hand to help and a heart to care. And Lord, we pray this morning
especially for our church family, for those who have requested prayer in our bulletin. And we name specifically Therese Paquette and the Acton Edwards family, Lord. You know the needs there, and we ask you to bless them in their need. We pray for our own families, Lord, and lift up our prayers for them. We pray over the AGM meeting that will happen today, Lord, that you would guide us forward and give wisdom to leaders and let peace prevail. And Lord, even in the midst of our gratitude, we experience dismay as we live in a conflicted world, a world where human tragedies are amok. Save us from despair and cynicism, Lord, as we yearn for your peace and your kingdom to come to this world. We remember the promise that you will never forsake us. Remind us again of our dependence on you as we venture in this life, trusting as your people that while the way may not be easy, you will always be with us, and that you follow us, that we follow your lead. So fortify our courage in the difficult places. Grant us hope for the way ahead, that our best years may be ahead. And give us assurance within our doubts and uncertainty. And now, Lord, as we remember your faithfulness, we pray together in one voice the prayer that you taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
We'll continue in our worship as we bring our offering and our gifts to the Lord. I think it's in Romans. Paul encourages us to let our everyday lives be an offering to God. And this is a bit of an example of how our everyday lives, our livelihood, become an offering to God as we give to him from our hearts and from our resources.
Praise to the Lord, the Almighty, the King of creation. Oh, my soul, praise him, for he is thy health and salvation. And all ye who hear, now to his temple draw near. Praise him in glad adoration. Praise to the Lord. Thy work and defend thee.
Heavenly Father, we come to you this morning with thankful hearts. And this act of giving is an act of worship, God. And we ponder anew what you can do, what possibilities lie when we give our lives, our hearts, and our gifts to you, God. And we pray that you would use these gifts to bring your kingdom in this place. We pray that you would bless both gift and giver in Jesus' name and for his sake. Amen.
Good morning. Well, you heard the words that I'm going to read already this morning, beautifully presented by Esther. Thank you. I'm going to read those same words from the Bible, from the Gospel of Mark, chapter 10. I'm reading verses 46 to 52. Then they came to Jericho, as Jesus and his disciples, together with a large crowd, were leaving the city. A blind man, Bartimaeus, that is the son of Timaeus, was sitting by the roadside begging. When he heard that it was Jesus of Nazareth, he began to shout, "Jesus, son of David, have mercy on me!" Many rebuked him and told him to be quiet, but he shouted all the more, "Son of David, have mercy on me!" Jesus stopped and said, "Call him." So they called to the blind man, "Cheer up, on your feet, he's calling you." Throwing his cloak aside, he jumped to his feet and came to Jesus. "What do you want me to do for you?" Jesus asked him. The blind man said, "Rabbi, I want to see." "Go," said Jesus, "your faith has healed you." And immediately he received his sight and followed Jesus along the road. May God add his blessing to the reading of his word.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Good morning. Once again, welcome to St. Andrew's. Thank you for being with us as a family as we worship this morning. If you are a guest, a very special welcome is extended to you. And we pray that God will meet you where you are today. And the words that we have heard shared with us in Scripture already, "What do you want me to do for you?" would penetrate our hearts as individuals, as families, and as a faith community. That's a question that St. Andrew's needs to be asking today, in the days that lie ahead especially. Jesus, we need you. And hear him say, "What do you want me to do?" And may we have an answer. But before I get into the text this morning, I want to take just a moment, a little commercial. And many of you know that this coming Wednesday is Ash Wednesday And I want to invite you all to a very special service on Wednesday evening at 6:30. We'll be meeting right here in the sanctuary. And without getting into a lot of the details, I have the honor of being able to presiding over that service. But I want you to come Wednesday evening, regardless of whatever background you may be from, whatever liturgical or non-liturgical. And I got something really, what I believe is important and powerful to share with you about one person's journey into the Ash Wednesday celebration. So I'd be pleased to see you come and join with us and be blessed as we begin this, what will be the start of the Lenten season. So that's on Wednesday at 6:30. Look forward to seeing as many of you as is possible. But now with the, I'm going to invite the men, if we have not, I'm going to invite us to put the scripture back up on the screen, please, folk who are doing the PowerPoint. And with that scripture, I want to look at Bartimaeus this morning. Now, chapter 10 is one of the three stories that we are told about Bartimaeus in scripture. Matthew and Luke also record this with a little variation. But I want to look at Mark's passage, because Mark specifically names Bartimaeus. The other ones, we just have unnamed blind people. But Mark gives us some specifics that we need to look at and to unpack this miracle and then make application in our own lives. Now, one of the first, and ought to arrest your attention as you read in Mark chapter 10, the opening verses, Jesus has already been involved with several conversations. He's talked about children. We met with the children today. We have a very important place of priority for children here in St. Andrews. Many times in communities, when children come into the worship, we shuffle them off immediately to the children's part of our facilities, and we never see them again. Personally, I think it's always wise to have kids in the service. They need to see worship modeled for them by adults, and they need to get the bigger picture of this great God whom we love and serve. And so Jesus had a wonderful place for children, and there were those who wanted to try to discourage children from being close to Jesus, and Jesus said, no, bring the little children, suffer the little children to come unto me. And so there were several topics that Jesus had already discussed in the earlier verses of chapter 10, one of them being where a couple of the disciples wanted a little favoritism from Jesus. And they said, now when you come into your kingdom, how about that we, because you know how important we have been to you, Jesus, you give us a little place of honor in that greater kingdom. And Jesus gave them these words, what do you want me to do for you? He really called them out. He exposed their selfish heart and ambitions, because they knew as soon as Jesus said, well, what is it that you want me to do? And they gave the answer, and then he gave a response. They could never fulfill what it was that Jesus and his expectations would have been on them. And so those are the opening verses of chapter 10. And then it goes on to say in that verse 46, then he goes to Jerusalem. Now, he's on his way from Galilee, and he's moving towards Jerusalem. So he is now moving south from his homeland, going through those provinces, and right there, tucked on the corner where you go south, and then you make a turn to the right. You're going west now as you're moving through the country of Israel, and there's this little city tucked right in at the top of the Galilean, or bottom of the Galilean Sea, actually, and it's called Jericho. And you all are familiar with the Jericho account, especially the Old Testament account. Well, we used to sing those songs, Joshua fit the battle of Jericho. Well, this city had been decimated, but now it was started to rise up again out of the ashes. And so Jesus goes down there. It's the last really large, and not large at all, but it's a large facility before he now is going to go 20 miles west towards Jerusalem. And it's an uphill climb, walk, if you would. And so he goes into Jericho, spends whatever amount of time is there, and now he leaves Jericho and is heading for the last 20 miles to Jerusalem. Now, I say that and I give you that because it's critically important, because these are the last 8 days of the life of Jesus Christ. He is now in his last week of life, and he knows what's awaiting for him in Jerusalem. It's Passover. But unfortunately, the disciples don't understand the dynamic that's going on, both in the heart of Jesus and in what he knows will be the last. And so he moves out of Jericho. Now, once again, because many of the residents of Jericho know that Passover is soon to be celebrated, it's the last large community that people need to go through in order to get to Jerusalem, a lot of the panhandlers are out on the streets now. And so these panhandlers are now on the streets, and they're waiting for this Jewish community to migrate from the northern part of Israel to go into Jerusalem. And they know that they can expect a few shekels along the way, because it was just ingrained in them. Their DNA was they need to give to the helpless and homeless along the way. One of these panhandlers was Bartimaeus. And Bartimaeus made his way out on that street early in the morning, awaiting for whatever was going to pass his way. And so, as we had depicted for the children, there was Bartimaeus sitting on the road, and now the crowd starts moving towards Jerusalem. But on this particular day, there was a larger crowd than usual, because they were following one man, and that man was Jesus. And so there was a large crowd, and it does say a great multitude. Now, whether a great multitude was 20 or 200, we're not sure, but it was enough that there was a lot of rabble, there was a lot of noise, there was undoubtedly a lot of questions being fired, a lot of conversations being made. Bartimaeus, although he was blind and undoubtedly kneeling or sitting on his mat, he certainly still had his ears, and he could recognize that something is unusual that is happening here. And so he finds out, and he finds out that it's Jesus. Now, Bartimaeus is in an unusual position. He has heard reputational-wise that this Jesus has done these miracles. Now, I'm going to give you a little bit, because the scripture already tells us that his name means son of Timaeus. Bar, the prefix bar, means son of, and Timaeus is Timaeus. Now, if there's Timothys in our group here today, or if your father was named Timothy, then you could say, well, I am a Bartimaeus, because it's son of Timothy. But you ask, what does Timaeus mean? Timaeus means value or honor. Value or honor. So here was a man who was blind, he was a beggar, and he was marginalized by society. He had 3 strikes against him. And he finds himself on a mat outside of a village, community, town, whatever we want, and he was depending upon the crowd to give him some kind of money to help him meet his daily needs. Blind, begging, and marginalized by society. This crowd comes by. He inquires, what's going on? And they tell him it's Jesus. And that starts the ball rolling in his mind. I heard of this Jesus. And so now he begins a chant of 8 words. And he says, Jesus, son of David, have mercy on me. And Jesus can't hear him over the rabble of the crowd that he's moving in. And so Bartimaeus says it again and again, each time the volume increasing. Jesus, son of David, have mercy on me. And the crowd there does what a crowd would normally do. They try to silence him. They try to silence him. Now let's just pause there for a second, because I want us to look at a couple of things. One thing I want us to ask, and I pray that it's not true of St. Andrews, but when someone gets excited about Jesus, Do we sometimes feel uncomfortable and would ask them just to chill out? When someone gets on fire for the things of Jesus Christ, do we become uncomfortable and say, I you know, he's a little weird, she's a little strange with her love for the Lord? Because that's what that crowd was essentially doing to Bartimaeus. They were saying, chill out here. Just give it a rest, okay? You're embarrassing us. You're becoming an object here. You're seeking attention. And we're not comfortable with that. All that Bartimaeus was, he was consumed with his own need and his own desperate situation. And he knew that he needed help. So I trust that's not true of St. Andrew's, that when someone gets on fire and gets to love Jesus and becomes wonderfully and gloriously saved and they want to move on in that relationship, that we don't find ourselves in that state of discomfort. Because many times when people who become well aware of their own sinfulness and they have this glory burst in their life of God's love, that just has to ooze out of them. And sometimes other people who love the Lord, but they're not comfortable necessarily with the way that may be expressed. That's a lesson for us, I think. And so the crowd says to Bartimaeus, be quiet, be quiet. And he keeps shouting those eight words, and they say, listen, please tone it down. And so he tones it down. Instead of shouting eight words, he shouts seven words. And he just says, Son of David, have mercy on me. And he gets louder, though, in his desire to meet with Jesus. And so he gets louder and louder, shouting over whatever the crowd may be saying to him. What a wonderful, wonderful picture of a sinner seeking out the love and mercy of God. What a wonderful picture. The length and extremes that someone will go to. He is consumed with their own guilt, consumed with their own sin. And they need this love of Jesus Christ, that they will bypass whatever the objections and barriers are that are placed before them. Maybe there's someone here this morning, and you're consumed with that situation in your own life. And the guilt and the regret and the weight and burden of that has just pressed you down so much, and you say, I need to meet with Jesus. I need this kind of an encounter with God. And there may be someone sitting beside, in front or behind or on the other side, and they may be saying, I don't know what the big deal is. But if you are this morning a Bartimaeus, may you find Jesus in a very powerful and wonderful and meaningful way in this service. And so he shouts. Now I want you to notice with me, Jesus in motion. He's in motion, and he's inching his way. Now, Bartimaeus does not know that he's inching his way away from the crowd, but all of a sudden, Jesus stops, and he simply says, bring him to me. And they know, that is, the crowd knows, that Jesus is talking about Bartimaeus because his voice is being heard over the rabble of whatever else is going on there. And so they go to Bartimaeus, and immediately their song changes. Cheer up. He wants to meet with you. Words before, they were saying, be quiet, you're a distraction. And now they say, cheer up, he wants to meet with you. Now, here's the pivot point in this miracle. And you're going to have to, preacher should never ask for forgiveness when he preaches, but I get a little excited here. When they say to him, cheer up, he wants to meet with you, it says he got up, and what does it say he does? What does it say? Throwing his cloak aside, he just throws it, and he goes like a bullet. He goes like a bullet to Jesus. Now, they may have had to guide him, and they may have taken his arm, but he wanted to see Jesus. And so he threw his cloak aside, and there's a lot of symbolism in him throwing his cloak aside that I want to make application here this morning. praying that in this congregation this morning, there will be people who will be saying, spiritually, there are cloaks that we need to throw aside. There are individuals here this day, if you want to see Jesus, there are spiritual or emotional cloaks that you have to throw aside. There is within this church community cloaks that you have to throw aside if you want to see Jesus in the weeks and months and years that lie ahead of you. There are those cloaks that have to be thrown aside. Now, what was that cloak? I think it's easy enough to define. That cloak was simply that garment that Bartimaeus used to sit on in order to make his life a little bit more tolerable for the day that he was going to be spending on the side of the road. And it would give him comfort as he sat. It may have provided some shelter for him when it rained. Who knows what all was going on. But when he got up, he made a very direct decision. I'm not going to need this cloak anymore. And that cloak went. And he took the arm and he went to Jesus. Now, the second thing I want you to notice with me before we get too deep into this is that he wasn't happy just to be with the rest of the crowd there. He wanted Jesus. It would have been good for him to say, well, just let me mix and mingle with the crowd and I'll be so happy because now I was marginalized, but now I'm a part of something significant. No, he wanted Jesus. He didn't want to just simply come to church. He wanted to meet with Jesus. He wasn't happy to sing the hymns. He wanted to meet with Jesus. He wasn't happy just to be a part of a gathering after church where we may have soup or sandwich. He wanted to meet with Jesus. And that's what we're doing here this morning, isn't it? We want to meet with Jesus. It's great to be part of community. It's great to be part of a fellowship and all that goes with it. But our hearts should be crying out, I want to meet with Jesus. And I want to have him say to me, what do you need? What's in your heart today? And so he threw his cloak aside. He goes and he meets with Jesus. Nothing interfered with him from that point on. Jesus looks at him and it says that Jesus answered him and said, what do you want me to do? What do you want me to do? Now, it sounds like a Captain Obvious statement. I'm blind. What do you mean? Oh, no. Jesus knew well that there could have been several other choices that Bartimaeus could have been asking for. He could have said, well, I'm really tired of living this life of poverty. How about granting me some money? But money was not on his top five list. He could have said, I want popularity. I just want to be popular again. I'm tired of meeting out here on the road and people ignoring me. I'm invisible to most of the people. I would like to be popular again. He didn't ask for popularity. He didn't ask for power. He didn't ask for money. He said, I need to be healed. I need to be healed. I want to see. I want to see. And so with that invitation, he invites Jesus to do something about his situation. Jesus simply looks at him and he says, your faith has healed you. Go your way. Your faith has healed you. And immediately he received his sight. Now, there's a couple of things I want to unpack in that for our application. When Jesus said, your faith has healed you. One passage says that Jesus did touch him, but another goes without suggesting that Jesus touched him. But regardless, there's a wonderful little word that is entrenched in that passage when it says that he was healed. Now, the normal word for a healing in the Greek New Testament is therapeuto. You know the word therapeuto, don't you? From therapy. That's not the word that is used for the word healing there. The word healing is sozo, S-O-Z-O. And that is, it's not just a physical healing, but it's a healing of the body and the mind and the spirit. It's an all-encompassing healing. And so Bartimaeus didn't just receive the healing of his eyes, but he had an encounter with Jesus Christ, which changed his life. It changed him. from what he used to be. He used to see himself as a victim, and now he has an encounter with Christ, and he's healed. That's the kind of healing that we want to see in operation in St. Andrews. That's the kind of healing we want to see experienced in this very community on this day of worship or in an AGM that's going to follow. People who have been healed by the power of Jesus' love. Now, I'm going to stop there, and we're going to listen to a song. And this song is powerful. And I'm going to come back after the song is shared. You're going to be an audience of this song. Listen, study the words. We're going to make comment and then close our message.
Blessed are you as you weep on your knees, with perfume and tears washing over my feet. Blessed are you, beggar, hopeless and blind, calling for mercy when I'm passing by. Blessed are you, shaking your head at two tiny fish and some bread. Blessed are you as you tremble and wait for the first stone thrown at your sinful disgrace. Tell me your story. Show me your wounds, and I'll show you what love sees. When love looks at you, hand me the pieces, broken and bruised, and I'll show you what love sees when love sees you. Blessed are you, walking on waves, to find yourself sinking when you look away. Blessed are you, lepers standing alone, the fear on their faces is all that you've known. Blessed are you, lonely widow who gave your last shiny coin to Yahweh. Blessed are you with your silvering eyes, kissing the one who's saving your life. Tell me your story. Show me your wounds, and I'll show you what love sees. When love looks at you, hand me the pieces, broken and bruised, and I'll show you what love sees when love sees you. I see what I made in your mother's womb. I see the day I fell in love with you. I see your tomorrows, nothing left to chance. I see my father's fingerprints. I see your story, I see my name written on every beautiful page. You see the struggle, you see the shame. I see the reason I came. I came for your story. I came for your wounds. to show you when love sees, when love sees you.
Thank you, Luke. And so, I don't know, Kathy, if we can get it back up on the slide there quickly or not. You see the struggle, you see the shame. I see the reason I came. Bartimaeus, his eyes were opened, and the first one he saw was Jesus. He saw Jesus, the one who has healed him. And so Jesus says to him, go your way, your faith has made you whole. The word go your way there, don't want to get technical, but it's not the same word that we read in Matthew 28, 19, and 20 that we sometimes call the Great Commission, go you therefore into all the world. No, it's go your way. The word actually means watching something disappear. Jesus said, now you can disappear if you want. You can go and go back into Jericho. You can go wherever you want. You're whole now. Do whatever you want to do. But it says that Bartimaeus got up, was healed, and he followed Jesus. He followed Jesus. Where did he follow him to? What did I say at the beginning? Where was Jesus going? Jerusalem. He follows him to Jerusalem. And there, 7 days later, 8 days later, he watches this one who has healed him, set him free from being a victim all of his life, opened his eyes, gave him life. He watches him crucified. He sees the one who loves him so much die for him. And so, as we close, that's the challenge that is laid before us. Are we prepared to follow Jesus on Calvary's road? Calvary's road is waiting for us. Waiting for us as a congregation, laying aside our own ambitions, our own agendas, and to follow Jesus. So as I see it, we're either the rabble of the crowd who would try to silence one who was searching, or we are the Bartimaeus. There's four things I want to leave with you quickly. I'm going to put them up on the screen. These are takeaway points. Seekers are not afraid to do whatever it takes to see Jesus. Seekers are not afraid to do whatever it takes to see Jesus. Is there someone here seeking Jesus this morning? Secondly, I want you to see that Jesus sees worth and value in people and never their past. Jesus didn't look at Bartimaeus' past. He saw value and worth in him. Jesus sees value and worth in you this day. He's not interested in the past. Oh, he cares about the pain and the scars that you're carrying, but he wants to move forward. Thirdly, Jesus' call on our lives requires change, regardless of how little. You see, when Bartimaeus got up, he threw his cloak aside. That was change for Bartimaeus. Jesus loves us just the way we are, but he loves us too much to let us stay the way we are. He wants change, change in our lives. St. Andrew's, be changing by the love of God. The fourth thing I want you to see, and this is the sobering point that I close with this morning, there will always be a last time for a person to hear Jesus' call. Jesus was leaving Jericho. He wasn't coming back. And that's always a sobering point. There's always the last time. If you're hearing Jesus this morning calling into your life to make a decision, run to him. If you are a child of God, praise him. Praise him. Let us pray. Father, thank you for the Bartimaeuses. Thank you for the Bartimaeuses who are in this church family. Oh, they had sight from the day they were born. But Father, there was a time that they recognized that they were blind and they were poor, not physically, but poor in spirit. And their sin had marginalized them from the Father. But Jesus came and Jesus healed. And now the sight that was once lost has been given. We are sons and daughters of the King by the new life in Jesus. And so, Lord, bless those who embrace that wonderful truth. And if there's someone here today who does not know that, may they come to Jesus. So we give that invitation, Father, once again. May your Spirit speak into our hearts. Stand with me as we close in our closing song this morning.
You're the God of this city, you're the King of these people, you're the Lord of this nation. You are, you're the light in this darkness, you're the hope to the hopeless, you're the peace to the restless. You are. There is no one like our God. There is no one like our God. For greater things have yet to come, greater things are still to be done in this city. Greater things have yet to come, greater things are still to be done in this. You're the God of this city, you're the King of these people, you're the Lord of this nation. You are, you're the light in this darkness, you're the hope to the hopeless, you're the peace to the restless. You are. There is no one like our God. There is no one like our God. For greater things have yet to come, greater things are still to be done in this city. Greater things have yet to come, greater things are still to be done in this city. No one like our God. There is no one like you, God. Greater things have yet to
What you have heard me offer before, I offer it once again, invitation for anyone who needs prayer today at any variety, something that has been said that has stirred your heart and you see yourself a Bartimaeus who needs to meet with Jesus. We want to pray with you. We want to help you come to Jesus and hear what he has to say and speak into your life. So that invitation is always open. I'll be around here. I know in 20 minutes or so there'll be an AGM that will be held here, but don't let anything get in the way of you meeting Jesus in that invitation. I'll be glad to stay long afterwards if that is what the need is, and I know there's a prayer team as well. But now I leave you with that wonderful benediction. Now unto him who is able to keep you from falling and to present you faultless with exceeding great joy, to the only wise God, our Savior, be dominion and power and majesty both now and forevermore. Receive this blessing in the triune God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Go in his peace. Celebrate his presence. And really demonstrate his love at an AGM. Amen. 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 And amen. God be with you.